I have a lot of stuff to talk and need to finish in 30 minutes. So, I don't see anybody outside waiting for my talk. So, this is the great. Today we are going to talk about Postgres in Amazon RDS. How many of you don't know what is RDS? RDS, okay.
Okay.
Yes. Okay, I will not talk I will talk a little bit about what's RDS, but I will dive more into what Postgres RDS is going to be offered. Okay, so who am I? First, I'm a database architect working with OmniTI for more than 7 years. I used to be Oracle DBA about 7 years ago. Then, since then, I haven't looked back working with Postgres, and I'm really happy. If you are a person who wants to switch from Oracle to Postgres, this is the best database to work on. I am working with MySQL and NoSQL still. Like, I prefer working on Postgres compared to other databases. My contact details, if you have any question after the talk, I'm available on Twitter 24/7. Blog, I write sometimes on my website. It's listed here. Let me give a brief overview of OmniTI. OmniTI is a consulting service providing solutions to the client to solve the problems that fall into one of these categories: scalability, reliability, HA, consistency, security. This is my first PGCon, but I feel like home, so which is good, and I think I'll be coming back next year probably. I visit other conferences in US, but this is my first PGCon, even though I am involved with Postgres for a number of years. So, and we are hiring. If you are an awesome database guy or operations guy or whatever guy or girl. Agenda, I can use this. Yes. Amazon RDS. What is Amazon RDS? We'll talk about what. I'm not representing Amazon, it so I need to give their overview as well, like their side, like what they are marketing and what's my review of it. So I'm going to talk about the highlights. We'll go through, like, there is a 5-step process to set up a Postgres instance with the replication setup and everything. So we'll go through that. If you want to follow through, if you have a Amazon RDS or Amazon account, you can just spin up your instance too with me. Postgres RDS features that we care about, like administration and some limitations, and question and answer. I think if you want to hold on your question, that might be good, because some of the question I might be answering at the talk progresses. But I'll be happy to answer any question anytime if you feel like you don't want to hold on. So what is Amazon RDS? RDS is the full name is Relational Database Services. So it's a managed relational database services. So as you can see here, Amazon has started, I think, with MySQL. They started with MySQL, then added Oracle SQL Server, and they added Postgres in November of last year. So from the maturity perspective, MySQL is the most mature RDS right now, because that has been in market for a longer period of time. And that makes sense. Service highlights, it's managed. If you don't know what is managed, means like you don't have to worry about hardware. You don't have to worry about installing the database. You don't have to worry about setting up the replication. You don't have to worry about failover. What else? Backups. You have to worry about little bit about monitoring from the application side, on little bit of database side, but usually they take care of as well. Compatible. So it's a compatible with whatever other services. Like, you don't have to install a specific driver or anything. Like, you can connect to the RDS instance using PSQL, using Java driver or .NET driver, whatever driver you are working your application in. You can able to connect to their database instance. just wanted to clear, this is just a database service. It's not like Heroku, like that provides application as well, lot of other stuff. But this is just a database. If you want to just bring up a database, this is where you go for testing maybe. Scalable database in the cloud, that's another highlight there, like it's in the cloud. Everybody should be in the cloud. Designed for use with other Amazon websites. So it's if you have Amazon, if you are already working with the Amazon, like you don't have to do anything extra to work with this service. You can just plug and play. And that's what they advertise is inexpensive, because the theory is like managing the database and other, those are the cost. Actually, Omnitia is providing the services, like we are doing the managed services as well. So it's, I think that makes sense. It's little expensive, but it depending on your use cases. Okay, so let's get started with the Postgres RDS first. So just wanted to make sure that it is still in beta. So if you are not aware of it, like I think I don't use for production for sure right now, because it's still in beta, and as you know, beta is beta. Yeah, but I will use Postgres 9 for beta 1. So once you have an Amazon account, you can just click on the Amazon RDS. This is the first page you will hit, and there are, as I mentioned earlier, there are different databases you can select for. And we always select Postgres, so let's select the number 2 in the list, okay? The next screen will be like, it will ask you for production. Yes, there are 2 options. Like, let me explain the second option first. It's RDS free usage trial, so that will, if you are just playing around, like if you want to play right now, you can just use, like it's free service that you can play with the Amazon RDS. But we will choose, like, let's assume that we are using for a more important database. It's a multi-AG deployment and provision IOPS. How many of you don't know what is multi-AG? So multi-AG is like, let me explain. Amazon has data centers in the different availability zones. So there is a region. Region is like US, Asia, those are the regions. Under that, they have availability zones, like US East, it's in Virginia, US West in California somewhere. So that's multi-AG. So if you want to set up that instance with the main instance, like the master is in Virginia, and set up a slave on the California, let's say. So that is multi-AG. Provision IOPS, sure.
I'm actually from that team. Multi-AG is actually in a region.
Right.
So it's just in like US East is where one region for multi-AG.
Correct. Definitely. So region, I think I have in the back in my slide, like it's not region, not multi-region.
Yeah.
But I just wanted to give the overview of it. Provision IOPS is the IOPS you usually pay for, and it's a little complicated than you think, but let's assume that we know about it. Yes, next. We will select the DB engine is already select the license model. This is not for us because it's providing other services like Oracle and SQL Server, so they need license or MySQL. Licensing DB engine version is 9.3.3 right now, so be careful about that. DB instance class is I chose like DB M1 large, like there is a very good documentation what kind of instances, like Amazon provides different kind of instances, large, extra large, it will depending on the how much RAM and the CPU power your instance will have. So I selected M1 large for now. Multi-AG deployment, yes. Auto miner version upgrade, yes. What does that mean? Yes means like whenever there is a, let's say 9.3.4 is available now, so whenever it will be available, it will upgrade for you, so you don't have to upgrade. And there will be window for that. Allocated storage, let's say we chose 100 gig. Use provision IOPS, yes. And then I said 1,000. So there is a ratio that you have to select. Like you cannot select 100 gig with 30,000 IOPS. There is a ratio, 3 to 10 ratio. I think we will talk about that in detail. DB instance identifier, OmniTI, master database, OmniTI, password. Done. Number 4. Now we will be selecting a port that you want to run the instance. Like default, I use 5432. You have a choice there. Choose a VPC. It's a virtual private network that you want to select, but I don't want to dwell into right now. Availability zone preference. So there is a preference you can select. Like if you are a startup starting in California, you can choose California as an availability zone. Option group is the template it will use for a PostgreSQL.com file. So I think I will talk more about it, but let's say we are using the default one. Parameter group is it's a para. I think PostgreSQL.conf is the parameter group. I think option group is, I think by default it's taken. You don't have to select in Postgres. I think it's for another database.
Yeah, there's none for Postgres.
None for Postgres, yeah. So you have to choose the parameter group, default Postgres 9.3. And I chose the default security group. By default, let's do that. Manage options, a backup retention period. You can choose up to 35 days if you want to have backups of your database. Backup window, you can select the window. I selected 4 AMUTC and 4.5, like about 30 minutes they can take a backup. It's usually fast, but if you are running very high transactional database, then backup will take a little bit of resources. The maintenance window is really important. So as I mentioned earlier, there is upgrade, minor version upgrade, auto minor version upgrade. That's the maintenance window. You can select here that on Sunday from 4 to 4:30, I am available for upgrade. So they will, I think, send out a notification and make sure that you set up outage window for your customers, and you can do that. And that's review. I think we are done. So now we have a Postgres instance up and running with 9.3.3 with 100 gig of storage. Maintenance details is there. Availability zone details is there. And boom, I'm connected. PSQL, dash H, hostname, OmniTI, username, and I'm connected right now. So in 6 steps, if your developer doesn't know about like how can I set up a backups, how can I set up a multi-AZ replication, this is the, like they want to just test it out. I think this is the really great way to set up an instance. Recently, I've been using this for a lot of like when there is a new things I want to test it out, I just bring up a new RDS instance. Like it's cheaper than like I spend time managing that database. So let's talk about the things that we assume that we knew before. Like in 6 steps, we assume that we knew about the configuration parameters and all. So one of the things it provides is pre-configuration parameters. So I am going to talk about some of the parameters that we care about. There's a maximum connection parameters. By default, I think it's 7 gig instance. How it calculates is DB instance class memory. So if you have, right now I have selected M1 large, so I think it's 7 gig of RAM, so it will select, take that RAM size divided by that number and put that maximum connection, 604. You can change it though. Effective cache size, by default it's take similar way, memory divided by this number and 3.6 gig for 7 gig of RAM size. I think that's good enough. Shared buffers is real same thing. You can change this, all these parameters. Maintenance work memory by default is 16 MB, but you can change it. work memory by default is 1 MB and can be changed. This is the parameter we cannot change, log line prefix. So if you are still working on the old Postgres log monitoring tool called pgfuin, that might not work, because right now most of the people are working pgbadger. Who is still using pgfuin? Fuin? Okay, so that might not work. I haven't tested yet, it might work. But pgbadger allows you to pass in the logline prefix parameter. Log minimum duration statement disabled by default. So this parameter, if you don't know, like it can log the statement takes longer than that amount of time, and you can enable it. So the first thing you can do, you can just do the enable, and it will, it's a on off, like not on off, sorry, this is 10 milliseconds or 5 milliseconds depending on your workload. Okay, so the process, like, it's easy to create parameter groups, and so if you think that you have a dev stage, those kind of instances, you can just create a parameter, the template for this postgres.conf file, and whenever you can create an instance, you can just pre-select whatever template you want to apply it. All those things can be done on command line as well, so you don't have to like use the web UI. So, and you can automate that as well. So, it's allow dynamic calculation, right? That's another thing, like people, it's really important, like when you change the, if you do the scalability, increase your size of the instance, that it will change automatically. And whenever the, if the parameter requires restart, the next restart time it will be applied. Or you can apply right away if you want to restart the dev. The cons is cannot change some of the parameters, but most of the parameter I think can be changed. One of them is log line prefix, but we have a workarounds for that. But usually if you are not doing, like, there is a other parameters like some libraries and other things, if you are using for your database, you cannot change. Okay, the next thing is automatic software patching. So as of now, Postgres 9.3.1, 2, and 3 are available. We are still waiting on 9.3.4. It's not available. I think I will. It's still in beta, so they are not fast in upgrade, maybe. But hopefully, that's the thing. I have been talking to Amazon guy, like, we would like to get it faster than it should be. You can control upgrade time. You have to wait till the new version. Like, for example, if there is a bug or data loss bug in exposed, or security bug exposed, you cannot upgrade by yourself. Like, you have to wait, you have to depend on, usually you depend on your DBS, now you depend on the Amazon. So Postgres RDS doesn't support anything older than 9.3. They started with 9.3, which is good, I think. And there's a replication bug in 9.3, so make sure, and delay in upgrade. Those are the things. Point in time restore. So this is cool feature. So as I, you can restore your instance in point in time. Like, there is a, in the dashboard, you can select a restore DB instance, and you can restore, use custom restore time, and it will restore your instance. You select the new instance, it will create the new instance and restore that snapshot to the new instance, so which is really cool. It will apply the xlogs, val logs. Point in time restore. So this is the new instance we created for restore Omniti restored. So it is restored now, and you can use that instance as like another instance. Another thing is snapshot. You can do the manual or automated snapshot. If you think like you are applying a schema or schema change, you want to take a snapshot, you can do manual snapshot that, and you can restore. If it doesn't go smooth, you can just restore to the previous version of your database. So it's really good for testing and development purposes. Like you can just restore it. You don't have to wait for your DBAs to restore your database. So, and you can do the automated snapshots too. Like for example, you can automate it every day or every hour or whatever the frequency you want. So, and you can use the restore. You can bring up that instance using the previous facility I mentioned about restoring. Another thing, it mentions DB events. Like it's still a black box, right? For devs, like they don't know where's my hardware, where's my where it's installed. So it keeps tracks of all the events. So there's a DB events that you can like starting from the once the instance is started, all the major events are logged there, like backup the database, creating a manual snapshot, finished when the backup was finished, applying the modification to the storage, all kind of events are logged there. So which is really good. DB event notification. Another thing is like if you want to just get notified if something changes on my if the database is restarted or whatever, you can set up like there are 13 event categories like backup, creation, deletion, failover, maintenance, recovery, restoration. So those kind of events can be notified using email or you want to get page depending on your preference. Okay, here I think my slide is a little off, like this should be the first slide. Amazon Web Azure, this is what the region and the availability zone. So region is, I think I still have a typo here, shouldn't be US East, it should be US. And then you have a different region. And region, do you know which, we have a, the California is considered as a region or?
Yeah, there's two regions.
Okay.
In the West, there's US West 1, which is,
okay. Okay, so yeah, so then it's right then, because US East is a region, US West is a region, but when you set up an availability zone, it's actually within the region. So yeah, so it's not from like you are setting up application from Virginia to California, it's from Virginia to somewhere else like New Jersey maybe. And then it's not multi-region. So as you can see on the dashboard, it's US East 1D, US East 1E. So those are the two availability zones that my instance is running right now. And provisioned IOPS. It's, I think IOPS is input output per second. So it's usually it gives you from ranges from 1,000 to 30,000 IOPS for your instance. You need to select ranges from 100 gig to 3 terabyte. If you want to get 30,000 IOPS, you need to select 3 terabyte or equivalent to that. I'm not sure what's the, I think they want to make money or probably, but.
It's about performance.
It is about performance, okay.
It's about latency.
Latency, okay. There's a ratio between 3 to 1 to 10 to 1. So you have to select into that ratio. So as I said, like 3 terabyte, you can go up to 30,000 IOPS per second. For example, I think I don't want to dive into this, but you can scale up to 2,000, 3,000, depending on your need. But that's really cool, push button scaling. Like when you think that I want to increase the IOPS for my instance from 1,000 IOPS to 2,000 IOPS. You can go back to your instance. I went back to the dashboard, my database OmniTI, and use different, I wanted to increase the space as well, so I just increased the 200 and set the IOPS to 2,000. And then continue.
Can I just ask a question about that?
Sure.
If you go up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, storage cannot be decreased because of the reasons like, because they don't have, I think, information about your database size or something like.
Is a kind of a fun thing when you talk about
yeah, But IOPS, I think you can go back. And I think it's online too. So that's really cool. You don't have to restart your database. So
can you restore down to a smaller one?
No.
It's a file system, right? So there's a lot of tricks to handle.
So I, as you can see here, I increase the IOPS. Like in the DB events, I saw you can see that there is an increased IOPS. So the event will be logged there. It took like about an hour for me to. So it's not like in 5 minutes you will get from 1,000 to 2,000. You still need to what it's called. I forgot about. But yeah, so it took about an hour to increase the IOPS from 1,000 to 2,000. Background there?
How is the IOPS being actually increased? If that's the question for you. We're actually moving the blocks to storage with more, spreading stuff out, that kind of thing.
Okay, thank you very much. You are here. Multi-AZ was quick. Yeah, multi-AZ, whenever I created a multi-AZ, first time it was really quick because the new instance was started. You can see here, like April 16th, I created a multi-AZ, and in like 4 minutes, no, six, no, it was created. Another thing is like whenever you are on cloud, you care about security. I have 5 minutes. So isolation and security, access from specific, like you can see like by default, it's doing a great job. It doesn't allow anybody to log in your RDS instance. So you need to set your IP address or your VPC from your EC2. If you are already working with Amazon, there is a security group you can define in the Amazon that you can assign to this instance. You can use EC2. The another thing is limited default roles. Like there are RDS super user role and RDS admin role. You RDS super user cannot log in. So by default, OmniTI is not a super user. It's a super user for a database. So if you are creating a database, it will be super. So you can create DOP, anything you want under the for that database. You cannot do anything at the cluster level. SSL is on by default, so which is good for cloud. So you can see so SSL and it's always on, turned on. So it's from the security perspective that makes sense. The good thing I like is like it doesn't allow by default to everybody to connect to your database instance. You need to define who can able to connect to the instance. Monitoring and metrics. So these are the default monitoring and metrics are already set up whenever you create an instance. It's a CPU, DB connections. I think we care about DB connections. But most of them are still missing. Like you do a lot of other monitoring too. So if you are using it as a, some right now we are evaluating for one customer to migrating. They have only 2 gig of database and we don't want to manage their Amazon EC2 instance maybe. And this might be a good, option for them to just bring up the RDS and use that. So it's a monitoring and metrics like the CPU, other utilizations, other features. Automatic host replacement, like if there's a hardware failure, you don't have to worry about that. It will be failed over automatically. And it's using synchronous replication. How many of you don't know difference about synchronous and asynchronous? Everybody knows. Great. That's good. It's a really cool feature if you are using it right. Postgres logs monitoring. Like that's another thing usually people think like, okay, the database is running, everything is fine. When there's a problem, how can I dive into the logs? So there is a console, but it's not pretty. But the good thing is you can download that log file. There are commands for all the stuff I talked about, like RDS. There is a RDS command that you can do the RDS watch DB log file and provide the log name, and you want to just log for error. you can provide this log file name, and you can watch the log as it happening. You can download the log file by every day you want to download and run into the PG Badger, you can do that. So I think, so you can do some kind of maintenance like analyze of your logs. Okay, the next thing is there's a limitation, like you cannot install your what's called customized extensions, but by default it's providing about 35 extensions, which is like all of the extension, some of them are missing, but PG Crypto is there, H Store is there, PostGIS there, T-Search 2 is there, PG PLPG SQL, so what's the good one, DB Link is there. So those kind of is all the most of the extensions are there. So if you are like, for example, if you have attended my colleague Keith's talk, like PG Partman, let's say, we talked about that with Amazon, like, okay, can we install this? Can you make it default? But no, not yet. So maybe we'll work out something, but right now you cannot install your customized extension until Amazon install it for you. As we are Postgres, we need to run the PGBench results. Yeah, provision IOPS 1000, number of clients 100, number of threads 1, duration 600 seconds. We did a quick test, single AG versus multi AG, like what's the difference of the performance. It was about, I think, 5%, like transaction per second, like about 200 and 186, about 5%, I think, 5% difference if you are using a multi-AG versus single AG instance, because it's a synchronous replication. That's the reason. And depending on your, like, as you know, like sometimes there's a high load on, then you might get a lower performance too.
And that's with you writing it to a machine in one zone and then a machine in another.
So that's a good question. Like, you don't have access to another instance. You have you just assume that there is only one instance. Everything is in background.
But it's written in two zones.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's written into two zones. But you just write into one, you don't know about anything. You can't access the different, the slave or streaming application.
If you're running just a single AZ, do you have a backup, a standby server to work?
So for multi-AZ, for single AZ, like, there will be backup, like, but it will not be the failover. Like, you will be missing the failover part. Right?
If the instance fails, it will get replaced.
Replace. Longer time. It has to build the instance and then bring up the instance.
So can you walk through a multi-AZ instance
failure? Sorry?
What exactly is happening to my application connecting to the database instance if that instance fails and needs to go over to the replicant server?
So it will be automated. Like, you will be still listening to the same CNAME or whatever the IP, whatever the host name you are talking to. You don't have to change any application.
It's a CNAME flip.
Yeah, CNAME flip. Okay. Yeah.
You get disconnected from the old one. You try your new connection.
Yeah.
Can you still set synchronous commit off for particular transactions?
It's not actually.
No.
It's not Postgres replication.
No.
Today, the multi-AZ is actually something that we built for all our particular engines at the moment. That's what we're using at this stage.
But no, you cannot disable the synchronous application.
I mean, well, you can disable the parameter that is the synchronous commit parameter, which would then change the performance characteristics of Postgres in general, which means you're not waiting on the fsyncs, which would mean you would have less of an impact on something like multi-AZ. So if you're doing bulk loading,
you don't want to do that, for example.
Okay. Cool. So those parameters are all under your control.
Right. Oh. Okay, that's good to know. I didn't know about that. Limitations, I think replicate, like we are still missing, like in MySQL RDS, you can set up a replicated slave and you can access as a read slave. Right now it's not possible in a Postgres. The limitation of upgrade migration, like you have to do dump restore right now. And what about major upgrade? Like we are still in the initial stage, but most like the client I mentioned, they can able to leverage the outage time, then we might be able to upgrade. The database size is small. Another scenario, we are going to use it for with the Jenkins servers. They are bringing up the instance constantly. They are right now have 4 servers for hardware, so we want to reduce that hardware cost, and we'll just use this RDS, and each Jenkins servers will create a new database.
Sorry, why are you saying PG dump restore is an upgrade? I mean, that's not. Oh, you're saying for migration that was.
Yes.
Oh, okay, sorry, I was confusing that with.
Yeah, migration. If you are running EC2 instance right now, you have only one option right now. You need to dump your EC2 instance database and restore into RDS. You cannot set up a replication. I think somebody asked me that question in on the channel, but it's not possible. Yet, PG Bouncer cannot be installed on the DB server. Like the client we are working, they have PG Bouncer running on the database server. We moved out that PG Bouncer to running on application server, and it's always a good idea to run on the application server. So there is no downside for that. Cannot install the custom extension like Mimio PG Partment that we are using for number of clients. So that might be a problem. Pricing, okay. So there is a pricing model is on demand and reserve pricing. On demand is like whenever you want to just test it out, you can just bring up the instance. Reserved is 1 year to 3 years, depending if you want to just reserve that instance for 1 year, that pricing will be low. I just compared with the single AG versus multi AGs. You can see the difference, double the, because you are paying for the failover as well. So it's a 400 versus 800, and for if you go to reserve instances, like it will be cheaper because you are making a long-term commitment, 10 to 20% cheaper, and price doesn't include bandwidth, right?
The external bandwidth.
External bandwidth.
And the reserve price is actually more like in the actually almost like 50% more, but it's only on the server piece, not on the storage, which is why.
Okay.
You get a blended cost, that's probably, it all depends on how many IOPS you need.
The on-demand price is the theoretical maximum.
Yes.
Yes, yeah. That's maximum, yes.
That's an hourly, you can.
Yeah.
For the multi-AZ replication, do you pay for bandwidth between the
AZs? No.
No, not internal, but externally, yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
And there are some references I used. That will be, my slide will be available on PGCon website under my talk. Further reading, my colleague Keith wrote, like we both wrote an article called Postgres, Accessing Postgres from Amazon RDS. It's on dbta.com. If you want to read, it's a very detailed article about what's RDS is about. Another thing I wanted to mention is the Surge conference. OmniTI have a Surge conference in September 24 to 26 in Washington DC if you want to attend. It's more about the scalability. It will be all like database application. And I think I am open for questions.
So when you say 100 gigabytes of the instance, is the size of data files or is the size of var file or is all together? What is 100 gigabytes?
It's everything. It's a you can store 100 gig of data.
So it's your, that's your database size, your wall, and your X log. And we back up and remove the wall logs. I mean, as their archive.
How about the server logs?
Your error log would be included in that.
Okay.
But not the binaries or anything else like on the server.
So when you remove the logs, like it's on like hourly basis. Or
no, every 5 minutes.
5 minutes, yeah.
So,
basically, it's a data file.
Yeah, and plus
almost.
So, I mean, because if you configure something with a like a really not large number of checkpoint segments, like if you said, "Hey, I got 10,000 checkpoint segments."
Are we still talking about the storage? It's free, right? 2014. I know.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding. Yeah, but yeah, storage is cheaper than anything, everything else. But yeah, it will be X logs and data files. So maybe if you need a 50 gig of database, you probably want to set 100 gig. In any case, a good recommendation is to set the data, the disk size double than whatever the database size is like for the growth reasons.
probably know the answer to this on the single AZ versus the multi-AZ when you showed the pricing. If I go to the lower one and take the single AZ, I still have the replication occurring.
No.
I have to go multi to have the basically the high cost.
Yes. Right. Yeah, that's the reason it's a double the price. Okay.
And part of it is that it's because even in the single AZ, if we had some fault in one of the availability zones, you're guaranteed to have that server. So, you know, if the high availability is really important to you, that's what we're basically going for. Versus if you're okay with a little more downtime, then you can, you know, your instance can come back.
You can't connect to the other side.
No. Yeah.
I think they are still working on that streaming replication.
Do you have your own standby?
Not at the moment.
No. At the moment.
It's the most requested feature so far. But.
Yeah, but I think as per the track record, like MySQL RDS has that thing. So I assume that it will be, there will be something. And it's not that difficult. If MySQL can provide, why not Postgres?
There are some other things like
that's cool. Sure.
You showed some settings.
Yeah.
And so forth. I was wondering if anything is known about what they've chosen for parameters like sequential page cost and random page cost. I'm mainly interested in tuning those for like my own instances on EC2. So I'm curious what they've.
So it's just select that free tier instance. And you, when you select that, there will be default, like there is an entire Postgres.com file will be available. So you can just go into the dashboard and see that.
We leave those at the Postgres default today.
Mostly the default.
Because of course, depending on what you pick for, whether you're on magnetic storage or PI ops and how much you choose as the ratios, it, you know, it's going to depend
on your application workload.
Yeah, exactly. So this, yeah.
If your whole application fits, if your whole database fits in RAM, then
the doesn't matter. Yeah. Okay, I think I'm, oh sure. The last question.
Not at the moment.
No.
Again, it's another real request that we're getting across all the engines that we're getting a lot more.
Because they just announced.
So you could kind of figure that at some point.
Sure.
We use EBS, so.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Schedule for 9.4?
They're still struggling for 9.3.4 right now.
In general, I mean, our plans are to support the major versions when they release, I mean, short, you know, within a short period. And much like our other engines, we plan to support major version upgrade in a, you know, just a single upgrade command model.
Yeah, I think MySQL has a 4 or 5 versions, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
I was a little surprised you showed a snippet saying that, like, a few versions of 9.3 were available, including 9.3.1, which has this known
bugs,
like data corruption issue.
Yes.
With standbys. But maybe the explanation for that is that they're using their own replication system.
Yeah, we don't use that replication, so the bugs are, you know.
Yeah.
And we do recommend, I mean, the default version is 9.3.3. To some degree, we provide flexibility for the customers because if a customer says, look, I'm on 9.3.1, I haven't tested 9.3.3, you know, I need another copy of my database. We don't want to tell the person, no, you can't have it right now. Over time, we will deprecate versions, but it's pretty early in the life cycle so far for us for Postgres.
Cool. And I think they are very approachable guys. Like, I have been talking to them for back and forth. Okay, thank you very much.